Today I'd like to talk about knurling, and I brought in a couple of micrometers to give you an example of knurling. If we look at this micrometer here, it has a diamond-shaped knurl on it, and we do this process for grip so we can turn whatever we need to turn a little easier. If we look at the one on the top, this is a straight knurl, and it's also being used for grip in this example, but it's often used for press fits. So if you put a straight knurl on the outside of a part, a pin for example, and press it into a hole that's a little bit loose, it makes the fit tighter. The reason we don't use a diamond knurl in that situation is because it tends to knock the points off the diamond and you lose any press advantage you had. You will also find this type of knurl on the outside of coins. I brought in a couple of knurling tools to show you, and it just grabs onto the tool post here. In this style here, I actually have a set of articulating heads. So what it does is it centers itself on the shaft. Now you'll notice these are the knurling wheels here, and this particular one has three different sets. So I have a coarse knurling wheel, I have a medium knurling wheel, and I have a fine knurling wheel. The idea is it goes on the front of the shaft, and as the lathe turns and it feeds, it puts that pattern on the outside of the material. Knurling is a deformation process, so in other words, I'm going to push material from the bottom of the shaft up to the top, creating that diamond peak. And the way it creates the diamonds, you'll notice that the wheels are set at an angle. So they both cut straight grooves, but because they're angular, it gives that appearance of a diamond shape on it. Now I don't like to use this particular tool, and the reason why is I'm pushing on the front of the shaft. So as I get further away from the chuck, it tends to want to bow the part in the middle a little bit. So I typically like to use the other style knurling tool, which is this one here. So again, it holds onto the tool post also, but it only has one set of wheels on this one. And then what I'll do is I'll just open it up like a pair of scissors and I'll put it over and under on the shaft. This tends to neutralize the cutting forces and doesn't push the shaft away. And then I'll just tighten it with this nut here. Now the disadvantage to this style is I would need three different sets of wheels that would either have to be pushed in with the pins, or I would have to buy three of these separate tools. So this is a medium knurl, and again, we have the wheels introduced at an angle, so it will give us that diamond-shaped pattern. Before you start, you want to make sure that the wheels are nice and clean, and you want to make sure that they turn freely. Also wiggle it sideways and make sure it's not too loose on the pin. So I have the knurling tool set in the holder. And a couple of things I'm looking at. I want to make sure that all of the connection points are tight. So the compound rest is tight. I want to make sure that I tighten the top of the tool. Make sure that all of the screws holding in the knurling tool in the tool holder are nice and tight. When I set the tool in, I want to make sure that it doesn't interfere with the side of the tool holder because it needs to move up and down. So this is how it self-centers. Then what we'll do is we'll bring the tool up so it's at right angles to the work. So I'm at right angles here. Now when I knurl, one of the tricks I use, and by the way this is not scientific, it just seems to work pretty good, is after I get it set square, I'm going to move the knurling tool a degree or two towards the chuck. And the reason I do that is I'm going to knurl towards the tailstock. So I just set it a degree or two by eye. The post is nice and tight. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to tighten this nut down and I'm going to turn in my cross slide and try and force the wheels over the diameter. And you'll notice that it is tight going over it. And I'm just going to keep backing this nut off until I can turn the cross slide so it just goes over. And then when I feel the tight spot and then it loosens up again, that should be fairly self-centered. Then I'll take my eyes down and look across the end here, and I will check and make sure that the wheels are over the center line of the part. Okay, we're now set up, and I would like you to notice that I have put a mark on either end of the shaft. That's where the finished knurl will be. You'll notice I have the knurling tool set before that. This is where I want to make sure I get the correct pattern before I'm committed, which is where the lines will be. Again, this is a deformation process, so this shaft is going to grow. So if it's going into a hole, for example, you want to make sure that you check how much the growth is where you're starting. So I would measure over the knurl I'm going to cut, and I would measure the diameter of the shaft. Then I would cut the diameter of the shaft that much smaller to compensate for how much is going to grow. Again, knurling is not cutting, it's a deformation process. I like to use 100 as a starting spot for the RPM, so I have the lathe set at 100 RPM, and if I was doing a fine knurl, I would set the feed rate about 15 thou per revolution. I would use about 20 thou per revolution for medium knurl, and up to 30 thou per revolution for a coarse knurl. Because I'm using a medium knurl, I'm going to use 20 thou. Again, this is what I find works well for me. It isn't necessarily scientific. So, what I'm going to do is turn the lathe on, and I'm going to start to tighten the nut until I get a reasonable pattern. Because this is aluminum, or if I was using soft metal such as brass, I won't use a cutting oil on it. But if it was steel, I would use a cutting oil on it to help assist with the deformation. Anyways, I'm going to turn the lathe on. It's going to be a little bit noisy. And you'll notice the wheels will start to turn as I tighten the nut. And I'm going to start to tighten the nut down a bit. And I'll shut it off and have a look at the knurl. And it's going to be a little bit tough for you to see it. I'll see if I can reposition the camera so you can see that. So if you have a look, you can see it has started to give us a knurling process, but it's still a little bit flat. So I'm just going to go around to the other side of the lathe. I now have the camera on the back side, and I'm going to turn it on, and I'm just going to give it a little bit more of a tighten on that nut, and we'll have a look at it again and see how that looks. And it's not looking too bad. So what I'll do now is I'll turn the lathe on, and I'm going to engage the feed, so you should start to see this knurling tool moving sideways. Feed is engaged. And I'm going to shut the power off and just double check it before I get to the spot I need. And I think it's still looking fairly well. Now, one of the tricks you want to be careful with is you don't want to disengage the feed until the knurl is finished. So I'm starting to get a good knurl pattern. I need to have a good knurl pattern by the time I get to here, and I need to run the wheel at least past the end here. I don't need to run it right to the end, but at least past this spot here, because this is the length of the knurl I require. So I'm happy with that. I'm just going to turn it back on. I'm just going to shut the power off as I get towards that line, just for one last check to make sure that it looks good before I get to the end. And I'm just running my finger over, and I can clearly feel that it's getting larger. Okay, so we're ready to go, and I'm not going to show the whole video, but I'll probably splice the middle out just so I'm not wasting your time. Again, it's important not to disengage the feed until you're done. All I'm doing is turning the power on and off. Okay, now I need that knurl to be good. So this is the beginning of the surface that will remain knurled after we cut the diameter down. So we're getting to the other end of the cut, and the line on the shaft is where the knurl will be when it's finished. I want to make sure that the far side of the wheel comes past that line. Again, I don't need to go right to the end of the shaft, but at least past that line so we don't get any discrepancy in our knurl. The tailstock is using a revolving center, and it is nice and tight in the far end of the shaft. Again, you can see we have one wheel underneath, and we have the other wheel on top, so it's kind of offsetting the cutting forces, not pushing against one side of that shaft. So we're just coming to the end of the knurl, and again, I just want to make sure that that far side of the knurling wheel comes past that line. If I wanted to, I could hold a rule up against it and measure it. As long as this side here of the knurling tool came past the length I needed for the knurl, I'd be fine to stop it there. So I'm going to stop it pretty quickly. And again, I'm just going to shut the power off and leave the feed on, just in case I needed to go back over it. Then what I would do is just switch the direction of the feed on the headstock, and I would knurl back over it. I prefer to knurl in one pass if I can do it. I find, even though it isn't cutting, I can get stuck between the knurling wheels and the surface that's being knurled, and it tends to give a poor finish at times. So we'll just shut the power off, and I think that is a successful knurl. How sharp those points are depends on what you're looking for. If you look at a handrail, maybe for a senior or a person who has a disability, they may not be as sharp, so they're not cutting into the person's hands. If you look at a ratchet or something like that, it likely has a fairly sharp knurl on it. One last thing I want to point out to you before I move the camera again from this side is I just want to have a look at the tailstock. So if you notice, there's still a little bit of room between the tailstock and the cross slide or the carriage. You want to make sure that you have enough room that the carriage isn't hitting the tailstock as you're knurling. And there's the finished product. There's the finished knurl. You will notice that the end where we started is a little bit rough, but again, we didn't need the knurl till we got to about here. And we ran it past the other end. Again, we will turn the diameter down and cut it back. And that's all there is to it. Thank you.